Good evening. I'm Cheryl. I am the Vice President for the District Nazarene Missions International Committee Council, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here tonight. I also have the pleasure of introducing our speaker this evening. Brooklyn Lindsay is an author, a speaker, a wife, and a mother of two beautiful girls, as I saw a picture of them earlier, and a pastor. Side note on that, she has a table in the back foyer and is selling books that she has written for $10 a piece and will be out there after the service to connect and to talk to you about those if you are interested in them. I had the privilege of spending a few hours in the car as we drove up the hill this afternoon. I picked her up from the airport and we were coming up to Prescott, watching the temperatures decrease as we went up the mountain. It was beautiful. We also had a wonderful time of discussion and getting to know one another. And I had the privilege of hearing her heart and hearing her heart for what God is doing in us here in the U.S., but also around the world. If you look up her bio online, it says, her heartbeat is for justice advocacy. Her hope is to mobilize the church, with a capital C, the global church, to interrupt the cycle of poverty and injustice in the world. As she shares with us tonight, I pray that you will open your heart to hear what it is that God has to say to you through her. I'm going to invite her to come up, and I'm going to pray for her before we get started. Join me. Father, I praise you, and I thank you, Lord, for who you are. Thank you for being in this place this evening. Thank you for allowing us to be in community with one another and to spend time with our brothers and our sisters. And Lord, as Brooklyn comes and brings your message and your words to us tonight, will you empty her of everything that is her and fill her of everything that is you, that the words that come out will be your words to us. Give us open hearts and open minds to hear what it is that you have to say to us, Lord. And then may we have the courage and have the strength to implement them into our world on a daily basis. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for loving us. In your name, amen.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and hi from Florida. It's 11 p.m., so this is going to be fun. Well, I do want to thank you, Pastor. I haven't got to meet you yet, but I'm so excited to be here in your house, and thank you for the invitation, Frank and Cheryl, for your company today. Anywhere I go in the Church of the Nazarene around the world, I immediately feel at home. I don't know if you feel that way, but it doesn't take me but 2 seconds to walk in the door and be like, okay, I can hang here. I can share too much information right now. It's totally fine. So be prepared. I'm going to share too much information because that's just how I am. I have this motto in life, go ugly early. Like, I don't want you to just see ugly later. Like, I want you to see it now because that's really who I am. Not ugly, ugly, but just real. So I'm going to share that with you tonight, and I come from a talkback church, you know, a church that talks to me when I talk to them. So please say yes if you think something is right or good, and say uh-huh if you're tracking, or say Google that if you're not sure what I'm talking about. And if I'm off, just send me a text and I'll make sure to talk to my husband. He finished his master's in divinity and I didn't. So sometimes I have to fact check. Especially when I'm talking about sports, I have a tendency to talk about the wrong teams and the wrong measures for winning and stuff. So just know that the parts about Jesus and the parts about my heart and the parts that I'm calling you to be a part of are all really true and real. But there might be some other facts that are 11 p.m. in Florida facts. Okay? All right. Well, now that we're all on the same page, and I have thanked you personally for inviting me, thank you for giving me this opportunity to be a divine interruption in your amazing story that's already happening. But I also want to thank the state of Arizona for something really special. I have not been back here. I came to Tucson for about 2 seconds a couple years ago. I don't know how I got there. I think it was a district superintendent thing. I don't know. I just got invited and I came and I went and I didn't get to see Arizona. But today I got to see it a little bit. And it reminded me that I owe Arizona a deep debt of gratitude. One, I didn't know what a Nazarene was until I came to Arizona. I'm from Ohio, small town, Ohio girl, Appalachia, you know, I don't know. I didn't know anything but Ohio and like 20 feet away. So when my grandpa at this church, it was called like a Nazarene church, invited me to go to this event called NYC, and it involved an airplane. I said yes, and so they sent me here from Ohio into 122 degrees, and I was 17 years old, and I was like, it's hot here, but there's also other hot things here. So I noticed this guy, and and it was really hot one morning, and I forgot my breakfast ticket, and I had to walk to the hotel, and this boy walked with me. And the night before that, maybe some of you know this story, but there was a gummy bear war. Like all youth events, there's something weird like that. So there was a gummy bear war and a fight, throwing them, and we had walked into the elevator, and he or I, there is still a debate to this day who challenged who, but one of us challenged the other one to eat the gummy bear on the floor from the night before. And so we did, because we're Nazarenes, right? No, I'm just kidding. I don't know why, because we're gross teenagers and we're disgusting like that. So we did that, and then we flew back to Ohio, and I never saw this boy again until another Nazarene thing. I'm just so grateful for the Church of the Nazarene, because they keep having these things for us to meet each other and become family, literally. So I met this boy, married him. He's great. So I want to show you a little picture of our family. But thank you, Arizona and Phoenix, for bringing the heat into my life. I'm so happy that I get to be here. We have two little girls. I send all of the love and greetings from the Florida district. We have been on that district now for, a long time, over 11 years, 2 years even before that, before we moved to Texas for another hot second. It's hot there too. So we are just so grateful that we get to be a part of the global church, and our journey has changed and shifted over the last 3 years, but God has really called me to inspire you and also maybe motivate you, maybe give you a little push into each other's arms, meaning like there are some of you here that maybe were born after 2006. Maybe? Anybody born after 2006? No? Everybody in my youth group is born after 2006. Okay, so maybe 2001. Anybody born after 2001 here? See, we do have one here. So you don't know the 1900s at all. That's fantastic. And then we have some who were born in the early 1900s. Do you have anybody born in the early 1900s? Nobody? Okay, we're just not gonna talk about that. But okay, so I just want you guys to see the depth and relationship that's possible here. I hope that you remember this weekend not as a weekend that Brooklyn came to speak, because it doesn't really matter who's up here, but I hope that you will remember this weekend as a moment where the story that you have already been experiencing here is just catalyzed by the Spirit of God, and that you begin to have these very special things happen, like the story that she told about going to Sri Lanka. These very special, specific movements that are happening in your mind and heart, and you will begin to see each other and hold hands and do things like you never have done before. So with that, I'm going to read Mark chapter 2. I feel like I've been camping out in this passage for like 17 years, so I'm really sorry if this is a repeat for some of you, but I just really am stuck here. And I want to share today, tomorrow, and then again tomorrow from the same passage, three different spots where I feel like God is calling us to collide and hold on to each other and to really carry the love of Jesus Christ in the way we live a missional life, in the way that we set an example for believers, in the way that we disciple one another, mentor one another, and build bridges to people who are broken, both spiritually and physically. So, Mark chapter 2, we're just going to dive into this, and I'm going to pray one more time because it's always good to do that. So, Mark chapter 2, it says this: a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. So this is a big deal. Jesus was coming home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. Then it says in verse 3 that some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Verse 4 says, since they could not. I want to just stop there. I don't like to be negative. I hate it, but I want to be negative for a second. They could not. That's what the word says. They could not do something. Since they could not get to him, to Jesus, because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat he was lying on. Okay, I'm from Florida, hurricane capital of the world, and we just got a new roof. Do you know what I would be like if someone did that to my house? I just got the roof. I don't know if you remember when Hurricane Irma came, but it was like a long time ago, and we just got a roof. So I imagine that this was probably a little bit of a situation, maybe. Verse 5, it says this, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, now, your sins are forgiven. Verse 6 says, some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Immediately, Jesus knew what was going on in their hearts. He knew it. He knew the temperature. He didn't have to get a thermometer. He just knew. He was like, okay, you're doubting this. And he says to them, why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to the paralyzed man, get up and take, or your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and take your mat and walk? You see, he knew that both were impossible. He knew that both were really impossible things to offer. And so he's telling them, you know, which is easier? They're both hard. Why are you asking me about this? And then in verse 9 it says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, to do the impossible thing, to bridge the gap that you don't believe can be bridged. And so he says to the man, and he looks at him and he says, I tell you, take your mat and go home. So what does he do? He gets up, he takes his mat in full view of everyone, and everyone's standing there amazed. Wouldn't you be? If someone right now in your life had an ailment that they've had for a long time, and there is no hope, there is no cure, and Jesus there with you looks at you, you're believing maybe Jesus can do something, so you make the introduction. Have you ever done that with a friend? You're like, I know them, and I think they can help you, so come here, I'm going to introduce you, right? And so these guys, not knowing what to do, bring a man to his feet. And this is what he does. He heals him, physically and spiritually. And then the people walk away praising God, saying, we have never seen anything like this before. God, I just pray that you will give us can-do spirits. I pray that you would help us to see things that we have never seen before. Your word says that you are able to do immeasurably more than anything we could ever ask or imagine in our wildest dreams, according to the riches in Christ Jesus. And so I pray that you'll give us wild dreams tonight, that we would have the belief in your power and your ability to do the things, God, that we might think are impossible. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I want to tell you a little story about Captain Crunch chicken. All right? Anybody like Captain Crunch? Anybody like chicken? You don't know this, but marrying those two things is the ultimate marriage. Outside of my own marriage, it's like the second marriage. It was made in heaven. So one time, my husband and I were on spring break in Florida, and we went to Planet Hollywood, and they made Captain Crunch chicken. And I was like, what, are you serious? Like, you rolled chicken in Captain Crunch? Who thought of that? Because now I want to roll it in Fruit Loops, you know, but anyway. So it was so good. And my husband and I went to college. We went to Mount Vernon Nazarene. I know it's not Point Loma. Trust me, I wish I went to Point Loma. What is Ohio? But so we get married young, and I needed someone to help me because I did not know how to cook. I had a macaroni and cheese mind. I don't know if you are the eldest child, but as the eldest child of four, family size mac and cheese, that's how you roll. That's just what you do. You boil the water, you throw the mac and cheese in, and then it does its thing in like 7 minutes, and then you just pour that powder substance and some butter and some stuff, and you just whip it out, and there it is, voila. So that's all I had in my head, in my heart. And so, I just married the man of my dreams. I mean, I saw him in Phoenix, Arizona, and then I saw him in Ohio, and then I was like, you are mine. And so, you know, we prayed in Jesus' name that God would bless this, which, by the way, guys, we celebrate 20 years of marriage on next Wednesday. Can you believe that? Like, woo! Okay, I love it. Jesus can do crazy stuff. So this guy that I know I'm going to be married to for at least 20 years, I'm like, I should cook something for him. And so I started watching Martha Stewart, which I don't know what she's doing now. But then she was kind of a thing. So I was watching all about how to make good chicken, fried chicken. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to make Captain Crunch chicken. I'm going to blow his mind. I'm going to be the best wife ever because that's what I want to be. So I made Captain Crunch chicken, guys. It was glorious. I was wife of the year. He was like, what did you do? I'm like, I put cereal in your chicken. Yes, I did. And it was so good. And I watched Martha Stewart step by step, like how you fry chicken without burning yourself or hurting anyone. Like I watched. And it was me plus Martha equals miracle chicken. Me plus Martha. Like, it was great. Okay, so the second time I tried, which was like 2 days later, because Captain Crunch is a lot, like it's a whole box, so you gotta make it every day. So I start making it again, but this time I'm like, you know, I got this, I know how to make this, it's fine. So I just started making it with my macaroni and cheese mind. I don't know if you've ever tried to fry anything with a boiling water temperature, but that's really dumb, and that's what I did. So I put the pot on the stove and just turned on the temperature like I would boiling water for mac and cheese, but I wasn't thinking, right? Because I was excited, because I'm the boss. I make good chicken. So we're in a little one booty kitchen, you know what I mean? Like our apartment, like here's the sink and then here's the stove kind of a thing. Florida, we just moved there. It's like $800 a month for this like thing. So this is what we could have. So he's over on his computer typing away on his seminary papers. My husband is very focused. Even today, I could tell him a whole story that the house is on fire and he is still writing his sermon. Like, and so I'm sitting here like just doing my thing, getting excited about dinner we're gonna have. And I look over and I realize what I had done, because I start to see smoke coming out of this pot. And I'm like, oh my goodness, like that's really bad. So I'm thinking I should turn the temperature down. I turn it down and it starts to smoke more. And then I'm thinking, okay, this is really bad, because I think that could catch on fire if, you know, I'm thinking correctly. So remove it from the heat. So I take the pan off of the heat. But as I do that, it was just like ready, I guess. The oxygen comes down and causes like a little combustion. And now I have fire in my hands in this pot. And I'm thinking, okay, there are a lot of options here, but I can't think of any of them. So I set the pot in the sink, and then I hear my mother from Ohio, who is nowhere near me, 15 hours away, don't put water on a grease fire. And I'm like, okay, don't put water on a grease fire. Well, that's helpful, Mom. What else do I do? I have nothing. I'm not thinking of all the obvious things, like anybody in the room has never made anything with oil. Just put the lid on it, for crying out loud. It will kill it. But I couldn't think. And I knew there's some powder substance I could throw on it, but I couldn't remember which one. And so I'm just like going into hyper mode. So this is what I did simultaneously. Women are multitaskers, so are men. But I'll just say this is pretty amazing what I just did. So basically, I somehow see the fire growing toward the ceiling. So I get the phone, which was a giant cordless one, by the way. And I call 911 because maybe they can tell me what to do. So I call them and I'm talking like, I have a fire. And she's like, ma'am, you should leave the house. And I'm like, no, I need to put it out. My husband's writing a paper for seminary. And she's like, get out of the house. My dog is starting to run around and bark. He's still like not even coherent of what's going on. So I'm thinking, okay, they're gonna help me. Same time, I'm doing the dumbest thing I've ever done in my life to this day. I get the fire extinguisher from under the sink. I have never used one, never touched one, but I'm thinking, I saw it there when we moved in, so I pull it out while she's telling me to leave, and I'm thinking, oh, I'll just get it out right before I run out of the house, except it's a one-booty kitchen. So in order to step back away from whatever you're about to explode, right, you can't. So I didn't really step back very far, and I didn't even know what I was doing. I just saw this like pin, it looked like a grenade, I mean, pull that out, I guess, and squeeze. So I did that. As I'm doing that, my husband comes to life, and he is like, what is going on? I am blowing like fireballs into the air as he turns around. The fire comes down from heaven, lands on the top of my foot and my arm. You can see I have a scar wrapped around my arm, so sad. This is also the night of youth group, by the way, so I was trying to get out of the house. So there's fire on me, but the fire extinguisher there was no room for the plume, so it had just went down into my legs. So what he sees from his angle is my wife's pants are on fire. They weren't. But he thought they were, and so he's like, your pants are on fire, they're on fire. And I'm like, oh no, they're not. So I rip my pants off, and I run outside, because that's what she told me to do, okay? So the lady's telling me to run outside, and he's telling me, like, my pants are on fire, and I feel kind of on fire, because my arm is. And so I run outside. At this point, some of my neighbors are out, like, I don't know if you know J.K. Warwick, but his children lives like, one house away, and she's out with her dogs, and she's like, Brooke, are you okay? And I'm like, I kind of don't have pants on and I'm on fire, but I'm fine, I'm really good. And then I see this robe fly out of it's a third story apartment complex, this robe. My husband did not even walk out of the house. He was like, I don't even know her, don't know what's going on. He throws a robe, just like a peace offering, like, it's crazy, such a crazy life we have. So me plus Martha is a miracle moment, okay? me without Martha was like disaster. And it was really a problem, okay? For me to have Miracle Chicken, I needed to be around someone who could help me. If I wanted my cooking to change, I needed to be around someone who knows how to cook. That's pretty obvious, right? Let's go back to our friends. They did not know what they were doing. They did not have a clue. It says they did not know. They did not know how, but they knew who. I knew Martha could help me, but I didn't access anything if I didn't get close to where she was. And I look at these men, and I see these friends, and they're looking at a need, and they don't know how to fix it. They don't know how to help it. They have no imagination for it, but they're like, but we know who can help. We know someone who does these types of things. And in that moment, the problem that they see becomes a possibility. And I think this is where we are in missions, in the work of justice, in helping others, and even comforting our broken friends when their marriages fall apart or when things go wrong. We see something and it breaks our heart so much. You know, one of our GSs, he told me, Brooklyn, just let your heart be broken, just let your heart be broken. The problem with that is when God breaks your heart, you can't unbreak it. You can't unfeel or unsee or unhear when you allow yourself to be around something that is powerfully wrong. It's really hard to let go of it. And so I am looking at this story and I'm thinking, when we have 1 billion people, nearly 1 billion people in the world who don't have access to safe water, sanitation, hygiene, education. It's not just wells. It's the ability to go to the bathroom and the toilet. It's the ability to wash my hands so that my food doesn't touch feces, it doesn't touch my face. There is so much sickness in the world that I didn't really even understand or realize. And then when I learned of it, it felt so big. I felt like I couldn't do anything. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm a girl from Ohio who doesn't even know how to cook chicken, right? And then I think, if I'm a teenager, how would I feel? Or if I'm someone who just had hip replacement, how would I feel? I don't know what I'm doing, but I know who. I don't know how, but I know who. And this is the mantra that you have to weave into your spirit. I don't know how, but I know who. And that gives you confidence to move. We started the justice movement 3 years ago with the Church of the Nazarene. It wasn't even a thing. They just called me and said, Brooklyn, can you do something, make something to build a bridge between NMI and NCM and NYI? And I was like, that sounds like a really big job. No, I can't. I don't know. But I know who can. And I left my secure, amazing Highland Park Church in Lakeland, like 10-year, like we had built like a youth ministry, like sailboat, it felt like. And I'm like, okay, I don't know how, but I know who. And to this day, I'm so grateful that it wasn't just me saying yes to that. There were people on each corner of that project saying, I'll go with you. I mean, I can calculate the distance from here to that roof. I'll go to jail. Someone else is saying, I will do this other thing. And everyone around me begins to be the body of Christ. And this is what will happen for you as well. And what happened in Sri Lanka. Each one of you had a vital role and you didn't even know what it was until you arrived. Because you didn't know how, you just knew who. So, what do we do when we want to carry the love, when we want to do justice, when we want to be a missional community? What do? We have to take responsibility for the needs we see. But here's where it gets sideways, because I trust me, I have lots of excuses for not making gourmet anything now. We have to look at not the fix, but the faith. Those guys weren't looking at this person like, okay, we know how to fix them. We're going to create a 5-point action plan and a Gantt chart and a grid, and then we're going to put it on Planning Center, and then we're going to make sure that all the event coordinators know. They were like, it's not the fix, it's the faith. We believe that Jesus can do something that we can't, so we're going to keep walking like we can, right? So here we are. Change starts with me. Change manifests in me and multiplies to we. When I say I want to be the justice movement, I say I want to be it, but I know when I'm being it that you will be it too. Because free people tend to free people. Healed people tend to heal people. Whatever is in you manifesting comes out of you. So if the Spirit of God is in you, you will begin to see the Spirit of God around you. And I wonder, how often did I sit there by that mat, by that person, by that situation, by that problem, thinking, I don't even know how, I don't even know where to begin, so I'm just going to mope about it, talk about it, pray about it, think about it, fuss about it, fight over it. But you know, the doing of the thing is actually the doing of the thing. Amelia Earhart said that, like, to do the thing, you have to do it. It's kind of genius. Then she gets in a plane and, like, flies over the ocean. That's what we do when we know Jesus. It's the me plus Jesus mentality, right? And it's not just out of nowhere. I want to show you a picture of me running. This is pretend running, okay? There is a Pilates studio in my town, and they were like, can you come? You're athletic looking. Can you be in our photo shoot? And I was like, is it a free trip to the beach? And they were like, yeah. I'm like, I'm in. Okay. So they had me stand on the end of this dock and run toward the beach multiple times. I don't know, unless you're a mermaid, who runs out of the ocean, first of all, from nowhere. Second, I don't know how many people go for a run glistening, not even, you know, sweating, with their hair perfectly braided and a, you know, perfectly tied sweatshirt around your waist when it's 120 degrees, right? This is pretend running. I am going from nowhere to nowhere, but I look like I'm running because I'm going through the motions of it. I want to show you real running. This is me in January, finishing my first marathon, snot all over my face, my knee is broken in half. I'm thinking, what is wrong with me? Why did I do this? I hate my life. I hate everybody who talked me into this. Why? I thought, you know what? The year I turn 40, I'm going to run a marathon. Might as well do it in January. That is the dumbest thing I ever did in my life. Like, sorry to all you runners. I love you. But that was just, like, hard. And my sister is in Epcot, because we did the Disney one. She's in Epcot waiting for me. I have 1 mile left, and I can't even run to her. She's 5 feet from me. And I'm crying, and I'm snotting. But here's the thing. When I'm running a marathon, I know where I'm coming from, and I know where I'm going. And I know that the next step is worth it, because guess what's waiting for me at the end? A big, fat, cheap medal. But I don't care. It's so much fun, you know? And I paid $190 for this piece of junk, but I'm going to get there, and we're going to celebrate, and we're going to eat all the Dole Whip ice cream that I want all day. Amen. Jesus, thank you, God, for ice cream. So that's the only thing that got me through it, right? Because I knew where I was going, and I knew, I had faith that there was something there waiting for me, even though I couldn't see it. And so many of us, we're pretend faithing. You know, religion, my husband said this in his sermon this weekend, and I was like, yeah, boy, like, preach it, because he was saying, you know, religion looks at what is. They look at what is. Religion sees what is, but faith sees what could be. Faith and belief sees what could be, and it propels you into motion, and you say yes to the crazy stuff, and you become the crazy person. Welcome to the club. So here we are. And Jesus provides the miracle, and I just want to notice real quick before we talk about Sri Lanka and a couple other things. When he heals this person, guess what happens? The murmuring, the, what are you doing? Now all the attention's on this man, it's not on us, we were here first. Like, we got the fast passes, and we were here first. What are you doing, ditching? Now you're taking all our attention. I don't know what was going on in their hearts, but it wasn't pure. And Jesus says, hey, why are you asking all these questions? I'm here. If you go back to Luke chapter 4, we're going to talk about Luke 4 tomorrow. But I came to free people. Like, I came to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, right? And to release captives and to help people when they're blind and to set people free. So what's going on here? I want to just note this. When there are miracles, there will be haters. When there are miracles, there will be doubt. When there are movements, there will be people who do not want you to move. When there are good things that you're doing to fight for justice or to share the love of Jesus Christ through the Jesus film, there will be rumors. You will become the crazy person. There will be negativity. There'll be straight up plagues. I'm not even kidding, you guys. When I make a decision for Jesus or when I'm avoiding one, I don't think Jesus calls down plagues on me, but something evil in the universe decides to kick my butt because we just had this big decision in our life that we're going to, okay, actually, I didn't make the decision yet. I'm lying. God asked me to do something, and I was waiting for another confirmation. Anybody? No? Oh, just me? Okay. All right. So I was waiting for another confirmation, and I am not kidding. The things that happened to my family that week, I don't think it was from God. I just think it was, like, total craziness, right? So my dad has a situation at home, and he becomes very needy. He never calls me ever. He loves me to death. I love my father. He's one of my favorite people in the whole world. He doesn't call me, but when he does, he really needs me, and it's all the time. So he was calling me a lot, and we had 1,900 things that weren't done that should have been done the week before. And then my daughter brings home this really special gift called head lice from second grade. And then I mean, that's just the beginning. And then my daughter, who's going into sixth grade, decides that she's going to be this person I don't know, and I'm going to have to take her phone, and then she's really going to be a person I don't know, and then she's going to destroy her room. And I know this is being recorded, so if you watch this someday, I'm really sorry. But that's what you were doing, being a crazy person. So she was being crazy, and my kid has lice, and I probably had it too, and now we all have lice, and okay, fine, I'll do the thing. Like, okay, God, like, are you putting plagues on me, right? That's what I'm asking myself. God wasn't putting plagues on me. I'm getting caught up in my own history, in my own life, in my own problems. The moment I put my focus on him and say, okay, I don't know how, I can't even deal with this situation that I created, I can trust in the Creator to take care of the situation that he can heal, free, forgive, help, bridge, you name it, he can do it. So we carry the love of Jesus Christ in missions, in Sunday school, in youth, with faith that Jesus can do it. They could not do it, but they took the man to Jesus. Jesus can do it. Your hustle, your muscle, your vision, your direction. Where is our NYI president? Dave, is that your name? Yes, okay, I remembered. And Sean, you guys have vision. By the way, you sound like Doug Fields. I don't know if anybody ever tells you that, but it's like very uncanny. So this guy has vision. He has hustle. He has muscle. He said, this year, we will ignite the faith of young adults in Arizona. That is vision. I can follow that. I'll sign up and drink that Kool-Aid because he believes it. I don't even think you know how, though, honestly. I mean, we've all been doing this for a long time. But because you said you're going to do it, Jesus is going to show you how. And I love that. And I love that about Dave. So, what are we going to do to give people a front row, an encounter with Jesus through missions? Through, how do we get clean water to people in Sri Lanka? You guys, I did not know how. What I did know is that we have teenagers on every continent of this world that are connected by a global church who can communicate way faster than we can. And I thought for a second, wait a second, I don't have to know how to do this. I just have to trust Jesus. And one by one, we started in Costa Rica. We started just talking about what does it look like to be the justice movement? What does it look like to be us plus Jesus? Us plus Jesus is miracles. Us plus Jesus is favor. Us plus Jesus is freedom. So I invited our students of NYI, and I invite every church, and I invite the people of my own church, and I invite you to imagine that this movement is a mat that you carry, but not alone. Because who can carry a person or a thing or a problem on a mat by themselves? So who is around you? Who are the other three corners? Who are you going to hold hands with and link up in faith and say, we don't know how, but we know who. And in knowing who, we're going to find out how. That's how that works. So who is holding this mat? And then if you're having a hard time imagining that, let's just rewind real quick. Who carried you to Jesus? Who got you a front row? My front row seat ticket, guess who took me to Jesus? His name was Rob Paul. He's a youth pastor at Newark First Church of the Nazarene. He was just this bald guy that paid for my camp. I don't know. I didn't know him. I just thought, wow, that was a nice man thing to do, to pay for me to go to camp. I don't know you. But that ticket to camp led me to trusting two friends who invited me to this Nazarene thing, which it could have been a cult. I didn't even know, right? So I come out here, and Jesus changes my life fiercely. And I hear preachers, and I get a call to ministry, and I decide in my heart, I'm going to help girls who are forced into selling their bodies. Like, where did that come from? I didn't even know what prostitution was. And Jesus gives me this vision, and I don't know how, and so I just take another step. And then who gets me in front of Jesus? Who gets me in front of Jesus next? The person at college who's like, hey, I think you're in the wrong major. You want to think about a different one? I'm like, I don't know. I just want to be a waitress at Rainforest Cafe. I like food a lot. So there were people in my life that just kept getting me in the front row. And then there were those people, too, who when I show up in Sri Lanka, you guys, right before you, maybe a year before you, and we bring teenagers from every region of the world, because my idea is that I would diminish that. Who cares about Brooklyn Lindsay? Let's elevate the influence of the students who have the influence. I mean, they don't know, like, this is your brain on drugs commercials. I mean, they don't. The language I speak isn't the language they know. So I'm thinking, what if I hold hands with them and empower them and influence them? And what ends up happening is they get a front row encounter with God who calls them to do things they never thought they could do before. And so imagine that kind of movement where just because you feel like maybe you've done your part, or just because you don't feel like you're good enough, or just because you feel like your life is too complicated, just because isn't enough. Because our role is to be the kingdom of God here and now. Whether we are paralyzed in bed on our dying days, or we just came out the womb, God has a calling for us. So, I want to introduce you real quick to Emily. Tomorrow we're going to talk a little bit more about her. But this Emily, this person, she didn't know how, but she got in her heart somewhere that she should help people with clean water. She had heard about a country in Africa, Zambia, and she wanted to do something. So this is her, Emily and Allison. Emily just graduated from Flagler University. She's with her sisters in Europe celebrating right now, I think. But she was 11 or 12 years old, and she comes to me and says, Pastor Brooklyn, I want to help, but I have no friends and no money. And I'm like, yes, you have friends. She's like, I'm homeschooled. And I'm like, well, I mean, she's like, I go to school with my mom. I'm like, okay, you have a point. And then she tells me, I was like, what do you do for fun? She was like, I golf. I'm like, oh, also by yourself. And then she explains that she sews. I'm like, ooh, another solo sport. We got to get you into some stuff, girl. But she tells me that she wants to do something, but she's feeling inadequate. And I did not know how. And here, I don't want you to hear this story and get caught up in the story, because this is a beautiful story. And it's way, there's so many more stories. This isn't just one story. What I want you to hear is that Emily had a vision for something, and she needed someone to carry the mat and get her in front of Jesus so he could turn the gears in her mind and help her imagine something that she couldn't do before. And so I said, okay, Emily, I'll take that next step with you. And so we sold some like little sewn birds that she had, and she raised some money for water. But I said, Emily, it's really about teaching others and educating others. So she became like this advocate at like, you know, farmers markets and all this stuff. And I was like, well, why don't I take you to this little event I'm speaking at? And so I brought her to Louisville in front of like 8,000 high school students. Just a little event. And I'm like, can you come to NYC with me? Because I can speak, but you're going to bring the story. You're going to bring the imagination for the people in your generation to understand what it looks like to love Jesus with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, because they can't be broken up. So you want to do that? And she's like, yeah. She didn't know how, but she knew who, and she just was relentless. And what's at stake if we don't get involved and link arms with the person sitting next to you and the person sitting in your youth room and the person that's dying in their hospital bed? If we don't link arms, we're going to miss the Emilys. We're going to miss them. And they are all over this beautiful world, and they are on fire. And when I go and talk about things like this all over the world, they get crazy. They invent stuff while I'm talking to them. They're like, hey, I created an app while you were talking about this. I'm like, awesome, go. Okay, so that happened in Japan, by the way. They created an app while I was talking to support justice education in Japan. We have this beautiful opportunity to be the church. We have this beautiful place. There's two more in two photos. This is Mexico. The very first place that I talked about. What does it look like to hold hands with NMI and SDMI and all of us together? And I was being translated into Spanish, and I speak a little Portuguese, but not Spanish, so I was kind of getting it all messed up like normal. And I asked them if they wanted to be a part of the movement of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of God, with their yes, with their physical yes, I'll carry a mat, yes, I'll do something even when I don't know how, even when life is complicated, even when I have all these excuses, I'll say yes, I know where I'm going, I know the prize. If you want to be a part of that movement, then will you come with me? That was a metaphor. They all stood up. They all came to the front, 800 of them. These are your church. This is your church. 800 Nazarene students that are your church who said, I'll go with you. I'll just leave everything sitting in it. I don't even have my phone with me. I don't even care. Do you know when I asked them to drink only water for a year, what a sacrifice it is in Mexico? Because in Mexico, a Coke is $1, 1 peso, and water is 3. There's an injustice there, and we could talk about that, and we could dig deep and get under that, because there's a systemic issue there. But to say, will you drink water to fight for the clean water that people still need in the world, even though you can't raise money, you can raise your voice, right? And so when I ask them to do that, they're like, yeah, I'll do that. And they're sacrificing more than just their voice and their time and their energy. They're actually sacrificing their own money. And so I come to you tonight asking you this question. What, Matt, is God calling you to carry? What thing has broken your heart in half? Because tomorrow we're going to talk about how to do something about it, how to move forward, how to link up in faith that God has put us in this time, in this situation, in this moment in history for a very specific purpose. This is a divine intersection right now. I don't believe that anybody here is here on accident. I believe that God has put you in a special space and time for you to hear exactly what you need to hear and for you to tune out everything else. So we're going to pray. You can look up the Justice Movement stuff. It's all online. It all lives there. I currently don't work for the Justice Movement anymore. I created it, but it's not meant for me to work for it. It's meant for me to be it. So all this stuff is available in English, Spanish, Portuguese, Korean, and French. And all of it is, like, my priority was that it would be inclusive because there's no youth ministry curriculum on the planet. Trust me, I write a lot of them. There's none that keep the priority of inclusivity like the Church of the Nazarene has with this. They paid money for this to be a voice in the world. So you have this tool, and you have this team, and you have vision, and you have students and leaders that are passionate about missions and communicating the gospel of Jesus Christ. You have all of that. So now it's time to pick up that mat and go straight to who? Jesus. God, I thank you for a chance to just share what it looks like to follow you in faith. And I also know that when I do that, I feel like throwing up. It's terrifying to say yes to you sometimes because we realize what you're able to do. That your power is perfected in our weakness is sometimes the most scary thing we could ever imagine. And so, oh God, I pray that you would just begin to anoint heads and hearts with ideas, with even just a heartbeat that is racing because someone in this room realizes that the story that you've been trying to tell them is real about themselves. I pray that you would just replace lies with the truth, just like you replaced the fear that the students and leaders had going to Sri Lanka this year, God. I just pray that you would do that for all of us, that fear and shame and guilt would not be our story, but freedom and value would be, that we would add value wherever we go with this huge spirit of yes, because you are able to do anything and everything that you promised to do. So God, I thank you so much for NMI and for SDMI and NYI, but most of all, I thank you for this gorgeous, messy, imperfect, anointed church that you've called to be salt and light in this world. So God, tomorrow as we gather and as the business goes on and we go through our day, I just pray that you would remind us of the mat that we carry and the mat that we were carried on. Make us grateful so that we would be so willing and so fluid to move when you call us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray together. Amen. Amen. I can't wait to be with you guys tomorrow.